And since we all know how these debates are conducted, we shall conduct them exactly like that. I shall ask the questions, and I shall not let anybody answer. And then I will go and ask the next question, and I shall not let that other guy also. And the only thing I cannot do here today is that because I'm not the editor, director, big boss of Mumbai Press Club, I won't be able to continue the show for as long as I want. I've been given a fixed time. So I want a request from all of you that please keep your answers short.
If at all.
And the questions long.
The questions, of course, are always long. It'll help if you answers, your answers are limited to yes or no. There is somebody here, our honorable new minister, Mr. Prakash Javadekar, who has a good experience of what kind of answers are acceptable and are permitted on TV channels. So all of you should be very, very clear. You know, just follow your own examples that you have set all this time. On a serious note, let me just thank you very much. A very warm welcome to everybody. Congratulations to our new minister, and our respects to Honorable Governor. And I'm glad the Press Club of Mumbai is doing this. This is, as Rajdeep and I were just discussing, Mumbai Press Club is putting up a shining example of what the journalists as a community should do and what they should be concerned about. So my personal gratitude to Gurbir and the entire Mumbai Press Club for that. Thank you very much. Now to start, can I start, Rajdeep, with you, that, you know, the question, did the media stoke the Modi wave?
Thank you very much, Uday. That's right, you know, we couldn't do this function in the Delhi Press Club at the moment because the egos of...
You won't find anybody in a sense, everybody would be drunk.
That's right, so, you know, we'd probably... And the egos of the individuals concerned there would be so large that you wouldn't be able to fit them even in a room of this size. I think it's an interesting question that you raise, because I think much too often, and I think this has become target practice, you also started it, that, you know, it's very easy to target and make, you know, be cynical about journalists, say, you know, we ask too many questions, some of us don't allow the others to give answers, present company not accepted. I've been accused over the years of mentoring all kinds of journalists, and there are journalists and journalists, I guess. But that apart. The fact is, I think, let's be clear, Narendra Modi ran an amazing campaign. I think it has been by far the most innovative and the most sustained campaign in an Indian election ever. When you really think of it, he started his campaign, frankly, in 2012. He had decided in 2012 he wanted to gun to be prime minister. For 2 years, he ran a relentless campaign. And therefore, you've got to give him credit. You know, this is all very well that the media fueled the wave. The man ran a brilliant campaign. And the number of meetings he addressed, the choice of meetings, the choice of dates, the way he went about it, I think really reflected a lot of effort being put into that entire exercise. On the other hand, you had someone who should be doing anything but politics. I mean, Rahul Gandhi has a lot of professions that he should be in, but politics is clearly not among them. And certainly communication is definitely not among them. I mean, I could think of Rahul Gandhi doing a lot of things, and he's a well-intentioned young man, but he's not a politician of the 21st century. 21st century politics is about communication. The great politicians of the 21st century are great communicators. So you have one man on one side who has a master's or a PhD in communication, who's a natural theater artist, who's a natural orator, who, you know, is made for this age of TV. And on the other hand, you have someone who frankly is in kindergarten. You know, there was no contest, and there was never going to be a contest. So to blame the media in any way for fanning the Namo wave, I think is unfair. Having said that, Uday, and I think this is the serious question, some channels some newspapers in this country, frankly, have abandoned the basic role of being journalists. They are either cheerleaders or even worse, do what I now call supari journalism. What happened to Arvind Kejriwal, to my mind, was supari journalism. Who did it? I'm not going to go ahead and get into it. There's another debate to do it. I don't want to make this forum out, he did this and he did that. It's not about that. But a section of our media is today engaged and continues to be engaged in the interest maybe of converting prime time into entertainment, or in the interest of trying to get more readers to your newspaper. You have converted journalism into supari journalism. And you have abandoned your basic function as journalists. What the pressures are, only they can answer. So they both have happened. And that Modi benefited from. Modi was never subject to the kind of intense scrutiny in the last 2 years that the others were subject to. And while he was brilliant in his strategy, social media, communication, he was spared the ignominy that the others were. And I believe that there's a fundamental reason that journalists must ask themselves and introspect, why have we reduced this great profession at times to either supari or cheerleading? I've seen some channels. I mean, the kind of journalism that they did during this election, you elevated Narendra Modi into God. He's a damn good politician, as I said at the start, but he's not a messiah. No questions were asked. Some of the interviews, and I credit Arnab, he was the only person, I would say, to some extent, who raised questions to Modi. The others, frankly, who interviewed Modi, need to go and check whether they want to do journalism or whether they want to simply do hagiography.
On that note, Rajdeep.
That's the simple tone. Sorry to be long, I would have been even longer, but no. It incenses me. It incenses me that we have reduced this profession. And why? To get an interview. To get an interview. Now, Modi won't give me an interview because he knows the questions I will ask. He's made me sit the last time in September 2012 on the footboard of a bus to ask the questions and walked out and didn't answer the questions the moment they were tough. That's Modi for you. I have no issues with it. But as journalists, we have to continue to ask questions. We are not bloody hagiographers, which is what we have become, and we are not people who should engage in supari journalism, which a section of us have become.
All right. I would have liked to come to you, Kumar, but you're not an anchor. So how can you be allowed to speak? I will come to you after Arnab, to that question.
No.
And you know, the briefer we are, the more questions we can.
No, I'll just keep it very brief, you know.
Come on, guys. You have to at least.
You see, I'm trying. But the audience is not giving me an opportunity. This is what happens when you want to turn a new leaf.
Correct.
And you say, I'll be brief. See, Uday, you got everything right in your introduction. You got one thing very wrong, Uday. You know what that is. That if you are to be like an anchor, and if you are to be the perfect anchor, Uday, which I feel sometimes when I look at you, I feel you have the potential to be. I think you ask the question, but you must also answer the question. The day you do that, Uday, the day you do that, Uday, then I'll retire. See, I don't know about this supari journalism. I'll tell you one thing. We work in a newsroom in Lower Parel, and I don't know if our audience knows it, but we are the only channel in India, a national channel, that is based away from the national capital. I mean, if you consider Noida national capital, then we're away from the national capital.
It's in UP.
Uttar Pradesh included. The advantage I have often asked myself of what is the fun of being in Mumbai for a journalist? I think the greatest fun, Uday, is that I'm not romantically associated with any party. You see, what happens is when you get romantically associated with any party, even including the Aam Aadmi Party, you might have a terrible breakup later. And then you'll be very disappointed.
But to come back to the and question.
I'll come to the question. So the
Modi
failure.
Way.
No, I'm coming to the Modi way. Yeah. I'm saying that, you see, I have always believed, on a very serious note, I don't care too much about what politicians think. Mr. Jawarekar, don't mind. And so my distance from the politicians is both physical and psychological. This applies, Uday, also to Mr. Modi. So when we speak about Modi and Modification and all, I believe it's very strange that we in India are overawed by politicians. We get very influenced by them. We begin to believe that we follow exactly what they say they do, and we forget that we also need to do something. To rebut your question, I'll give you three examples. And by the way, I'm not cynical about this profession. I am very, 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 very optimistic about this profession. I believe that but everything that Gurbir has said, I think the next 10 years are going to be terrific for India, especially for news television. But I would like to caveat that by saying that this time, Modi didn't tell us to cover Muzaffarnagar. Modi didn't tell us to ask that Principal Secretary Home Anil Gupta why he said when 32 children died in Muzaffarnagar, he said that, you know, children don't die in Siberia, people don't die in Siberia, what are you complaining about? Modi didn't ask us to ask that question. Modi didn't tell us to send a camera behind Azam Khan while he was having that holiday in Venice on government money, or question why Salman Khan is shaking a leg at Sci-Fi. These are not stories that Modi asked us to do. Modi was an interesting character in a very unipolar election. And frankly, the emphasis on Modi was very great, also because there was no competition, as Rajdeep rightly says. There's no competition in this election. So the focus principally becomes on one character. But I completely disagree that if you look at the entire 4 or 5 months from January to March, right, starting from, say, when Rahul Gandhi gave an interview or started his campaign, right up to the results, Modi perhaps got about 30% of the time, 70% of the time, and I'm not talking speeches, were around issues that were not centered around Mr. Modi. So I think we get unnecessarily perturbed, and for all independent thinking journalists out there, I'd like to say, don't worry. You know, we are not dependent upon a political figure. When people tell me, Modi is shown because he gets us ratings. I mean, there are many ways you can get ratings. Mr. Modi is not certainly getting you ratings. There is no scientific evidence that Modi gets you ratings. These are all facetious thoughts in our own mind. And, you know, part of the problem is that our entire media is based out of Delhi. And a lot of the journalists and a lot of the editors get too close to the people in power, or want to be close, or worry what will happen if somebody comes, what if somebody goes, what if we have a breakup with someone. When you break your mind out of that set, you actually make yourself independent as a journalist. So I think our group of people in Lower Parel are doing that every day. As far as we are concerned, we're neither overly impressed or worried about a Modi wave.
Thank you, Arnab. Before I come to Kumar, I just have to make one observation of my own. I completely agree with Arnab on the future of journalism. I think there are lots of things that we don't like about media, and we should be very critical and put the spotlight on ourselves as often as we can. But I think the future of journalism is bright, and it will continue to bright no matter what the pressure is, because we don't do something that is trivial to the society. We do something which is very, very central to the society. And even for Indian media, even for all the battering that Indian media takes from other people and within the community, do you think this country would have been better off or worse off without us? The answer is definitely much, much worse off. So thank God for us. We are bad. We need to get much better. But God save this country if we are not around. On that note, Kumar, to you. Do you think, as a journalist and as a frequent participant, do you think the media created or stoked a Modi wave? And to you, I'll also like to ask a question. Do you think the Congress party stoked the Modi wave?
Well, actually, that part of the question is absolutely right. It is Congress party which stoked the Modi wave, but that does not mean that media did not.
Okay.
The point is that while agreeing with Rajdeep that he is a great communicator, or with Arnab saying that they are not part of the Supari journalism, let us not forget that the original term for great communicator was made by Walter Lippmann to Mahatma Gandhi. And Mahatma Gandhi did not have a color television. And yet he was a communicator. He could influence people from Nagaland to Tamil Nadu. He did not know Naga languages, that is the Naga dialects, and he did not know Tamil. Only Gujarati, before Narendra Modi, who was a great communicator without television, without digital media. Now, how he organized that campaign with only a small mic written Chicago, and that mic hardly communicated what he was trying to say. And yet, he communicated across the country in multiple languages and created a wave which was genuinely freedom movement wave. So let us not talk about the skills of Modi as great communicator. They are there, but they are essentially great communication that Modi organized while granting him the, actually granting him the credit for that. Let us not forget, without media, and mainly without electronic media, this wave would not have come. And the fact is that initially there was no Modi wave. Initially there was only Gujarat model. How many electronic channels, or for that matter print media journalists, went to Gujarat villages, went to that Sabarmati river, went to all the hospitals and the schools where nothing was happening in terms of development, and yet no media has covered in detail Gujarat. They have covered Bihar, how miserable Bihar is. They have covered Uttar Pradesh, how miserable Uttar Pradesh is. They have covered Marathwada drought. They have covered Marathwada drought as if it was an international news. But they did not cover the floods in Gujarat, which actually wiped out many parts of Surat, Baroda, Ahmedabad at the time when Modi was campaigning at the top of his campaign trip. Nobody covered that. The accident which took place on May 26, on his swearing-in day, media did not cover that accident. 40 people had died. Otherwise, all railway accidents make headline 8-column news, and what is the railway minister doing? Granted, there was no railway minister. But the fact is there was railway accident. There was riot on the same evening in Ahmedabad between Hindus and Muslims. Later on, after the Muslim youth was killed, the Techie youth was killed, in Kolhapur, in Maharashtra, there were regular riots, and only the shops and the houses of the Muslims were burned. Media did not cover.
So your point is?
Media did not cover. Media did not cover certainly as much as they should have. Media did not cover as much as they should have. And by not covering also you can stoke fire.
Sure.
It is not necessary that you have to actually promote somebody. By not doing something also you can promote. And I think that has happened. Maybe some individual channel has done something. But the fact is, that Modi was treated not only with soft gloves, but Modi was pampered by the media. Whether we call it stoking the fire or not, I don't know. But Modi was pampered, and it is not necessary to defend Congress for that or offend Congress for that. Congress may be good, bad, otherwise. Rahul may be good, bad, otherwise. Sonia may be good, bad, otherwise. And Manmohan Singh may have suffered from policy paralysis. But harping continuously on the policy paralysis of one party and one government without talking about 1,38,000 crore debt that Gujarat government has got, and if you constantly talk only about what government of India is failing in, and without talking about what Gujarat government is failing
before
in, I think that is stoking.
Before you turn it into news hour at 7:30,
that
let me
is
just
stoking.
Move on.
And stoking fire does
That's
not
right.
mean
we
not calling point. Fire brigade when the fire is on is also stoking fire.
Now, on second thoughts, I should have been sitting between Arnab and Kumar, because whenever they are together, Kumar can't stop. But there's a brand genius of our generation who's sitting here. I'll come to him about why media, if it did put special emphasis or put the camera on Modi more often than it should have, what was the reason for that? But before that, I just have one point to make to all of you. And to you, Kumar, I think you cannot clearly look at it probably from the lens of why was the media looking at the Congress government more. Congress government had been in power for 10 years. Modi had a distinct advantage that he was the challenger. He was at best, he was just a state chief minister. But in this election, he was the challenger. Obviously, it's the incumbent who's always under the scrutiny. It's not about elections, it's in everything. The new guy is not under so much scrutiny as the incumbent. So that was one huge advantage. It's another matter that the Congress party, in my view, and some of the leaders of the Congress party, I don't know whether Prime Minister Modi has gone and thanked those leaders for having helped him, turning this election into a national referendum. But before I go to the next part of my question,
You tell me, from a brand point of view, what
happened? I think it's a very interesting situation. After a match is over, there's a post-mortem going on. And there are two sides to it. One is kicking your backside for doing something which you now feel should not have been done. Or some people did something more than it should have been done. My very simple question to you as human beings, you happen to be journalists, I happen to be a writer in advertising. End of the day, Modi didn't give you a chance to ignore him. Let's accept that fact very, very clearly. Whether you went overboard or you went underboard. Modi was a factor that happened from 2012 onwards, as you rightly said, doing things with public talking about him. You had no option of ignoring Modi. Now, some people may think that Arnav went overboard. Some people may think the journalists went overboard. Some people may think that things were given this way. I'm asking you a very simple question. As a human being, when India wins, why do you keep going Dhoni, Dhoni, Dhoni? You are a human being. You are influenced by what is happening around you. And sometimes there is a possibility that you might give a little more emphasis. What was just said about the railway accident. Now, in hindsight, you can say that that was not reported. But on 15th of August is 15th of August. The paper is orange, white, and green that day. Some news becomes smaller. So I'm not blaming anybody. I'm not saying that you did it deliberately. But do not kick yourselves so badly. Your journalists are not so bad, I would like to believe. I would like to believe that there is a priority of the day. There is a mood of the day. And the mood of the day and the mood of the last 2 years was Modi, and you had no option of ignoring it. As simple as that.
Thanks, Piyush. Mm-hmm. Thanks for the answer. Thanks for being brief. And I should also, in all fairness, point out that Modi was in, Piyush was involved with the BJP and Modi campaign.
I think there's a very interesting thing. When you talk about the wave, somebody one day said, like you were saying, that media created the wave. Don't take yourself so seriously. Yeah, you're not that important. One media person, media buyer, once said to me, we created the wave. I said, don't take yourself so damn seriously. We rode the wave. We did not create the wave. Now, the creator of the wave was Modi, and Modi alone.
That's a very good point. We might not have created the wave, but did the media ride the wave or try to ride the wave? That's the question that I have for you, Arnav. That, I personally think I'm in the business of media, but I'm an outsider to the business of news, so I was observing things with a lack of passion that probably you can't have when you're a journalist. And the one thing I noticed was that the act of stunning genius on the part of the BJP and Modi camp was the fact that they turned it into a binary referendum completely between him and Rahul Gandhi and between him or at most the Gandhi family. Right. And that was a no match. You know, that was Roger Federer versus Leander Paes from day one. My question is, why did the media get sucked into that binary setup, that the political party, the BJP, it was a strategy that they decided to make it a binary choice and that's how they presented it to the country. Why did you not see through that and said the choices are larger, the issues are somewhat more different? Why could you not recontextualize the whole thing?
I mean, leadership is a very big issue in this country. I mean, why are we getting moralistic about it? A fact of the matter is people wanted leadership. I think it was a mortal sin, Uday. Sometime back, I'll remember, January 2011. So we broke the CWG scam in June 2010. And there were six scams till January 2011. It was the first time I ever went to Racecourse Road. I've never been to PM's house before that. So the first time I went, I was looking around. There were other editors who used to walk in and out every day. And there were questions being asked. Now, that scam happened right 1 or 2 days after the Devas ISRO scam broke out. Rajdeep will remember. The Devas ISRO scam was the biggest damn thing which was being spoken everywhere in the country at that time. And I was the 13th or 14th unfortunate editor to be asked to ask a question. Even when I started to ask, I was stopped. And before that, there was another editor who asked the Prime Minister what his or her message would be to Sachin Tendulkar. I mean, I was looking around me and I was saying, where am I? I mean, you know, this country made it such a situation where it was a sin to criticize Manmohan Singh. And same Latin's Delhi made it a sin to criticize Manmohan Singh in 2011. So you're talking about this binary construct. This binary construct is a immediate after effect of the fact that you made it a sin to criticize a prime minister who would not take a position as scam after scam broke all around him. And therefore, leadership became a very important issue. So first point is, I'm not going to take a moral position on that.
Wait.
You have different rules for me.
I have learned from you. No, I'm only asking.
One point. Let me complete on the point.
Let him ask.
Let me make a point on what Piyush said. This question is this entire debate. Sorry, I'll give it back to you. The entire debate is predicated around a simple premise that did we modify the election to make Modi win, right? So did we Kejrify the election to make Kejriwal lose? I mean, what kind of a question is that? We are taking ourselves, I take exactly what Piyush says, we're taking ourselves too seriously. I'll give it back.
You can't hide behind that, you know, when it suits you that you're taking yourself too seriously. You of all the people can't make that argument to hide behind that, number one. Number two, it's not about whether you take yourself too seriously. It's not a moral question that I asked. It's a very factual question. The Indian elections are, of course, there is leadership, and each party is led by a leader, and eventually it's about the election of a prime minister. But Indian elections are not the elections of two individuals. And that I'm asking a factual question. The one thing that I found missing in the media context, and that question is for you, Rajdeep, that it was, why did you, I mean, you sounded a little disturbed about the way the media behaved. Why did you or your channel or the other people who were not so, let's say, who were not happy about what was happening in media, why were they not able to put the right context and extend the scope of the debate and the electoral focus?
Look, I think there is a problem of being prisoners of format. We are converting this also into becoming prisoners of format, where whoever shouts louder, screeches louder, wins out. And I think somewhere 24/7 has also fallen into that trap. The ability to actually go beyond the headline. You know, Kumar may sort of, you know, there are huge positives to the Gujarat model as well. The Jyotigram scheme of Modi, for example, which again needs to be explained, understood by the average viewer. We have reduced our coverage of news on television to he said, she said, cockfight. That is the reality. We've also failed, for example, 1.76 lakh crore telecom scam, the biggest scandal of the CAG ever. You cannot have a 1.76 lakh telecom scam. Did we? But there was fear that if I started questioning the CAG, would I be seen by some to be holding a brief for the Prime Minister and the Government of India? That's the truth. Let's be clear. You cannot have a 1.76 lakh crore telecom scam. It was presumptive loss, but we were unwilling to do that. Actually, the real problems of the media started 2010, 11, 12. Manmohan Singh is... Look, you had a prime minister on silent mode. He had no chance. In the age of communication, and his spokespersons were people who made it even worse. They were soft targets, come every night, and they made it worse for the party. But remember one thing, Uday. Indian elections are not just won or lost on television or whatever.
It'll never be.
Exactly.
I think
the fact is, you've had a unique election where Mayawati got 0 seats. You've had a unique election where the likes of Nitish Kumar, who, whether you like it or not, has changed the face of Bihar in many ways, ended up with 2 or 3 seats. You had a unique election where a national conference blanked out. DMK blanked out. This is not a normal election. It was not a wave election. It was a tsunami election. So no conventional wisdoms, no ideas that television makes or breaks will hold anymore. My bigger problem, and I think you have a point, is that somewhere we have lost. I mean, I believe, sadly, the glass is half empty. I believe we have lost the capacity to actually go beyond the dramatic headline. 1.76 lakh crores telecom scam, great headline. It sounds great. Are we willing to go beyond that and actually start questioning the CAG? We won't, because we've lost our nerve, frankly. And that's what has happened. We are the Gujarat model. Are we willing to do a serious interrogation of the Gujarat model, positives and negatives? Inability. There's a lack of, there's good journalism, and you'll have many of them being awarded today. Requires effort. We are now doing masala journalism. Let's be, I use word supari, I'll call it masala. And we can go on saying that in the next 10 years, we are going to be so great and how we are going to change this country. Arrogance is the downfall of every journalism.
But the question...
And we have become arrogant. We may say in this gathering, Uday, we will say that we don't break or make politicians. When we go on air or when we write in our byline in bold, every editor, in my time, no editor took front page to write this big byline of his, where the editor became more important than the copy. Or today, when in prime time television, what the anchor says matters than what the guests say. That is the truth.
You're all...
And we don't want to face it. Because we have got caught in our arrogance.
No, that's...
And unless, because, and if we don't do that, your question will never get answered. You have raised a valid question which will never get answered, not today, not 5 years from now, not 10 years from now. Is journalism willing to do the serious interrogation of what goes on in society around us? Or are we so convinced about ourselves and what we are that we don't care? We really don't care anymore. So we will not even do a serious introspection on whether, you know, why, for example, Mayawati got zero seats. Have I seen a serious
I'm
piece?
I'm coming to that.
I haven't seen a serious piece written in a newspaper or in a television channel on why Mayawati got zero seats.
No, I'll come to that.
And I don't think 10 or 15 years ago that would have been the case.
You know,
10 or 15 years ago, your editor would have told you, go and find out why that has happened.
Look,
And even Muzaffarnagar. Look at the way we covered Muzaffarnagar. I will contrast the way we covered Muzaffarnagar with the way we covered previous riots.
Rajdeep.
It's true.
I agree with you. But there are two points that, and I'm coming to you, Kumar. There are two points that I want to make. First of all, media taking itself too seriously is not quite the same as the impact of media being omnipresent or, you know, too much. That, let's make the distinction between, we might take ourselves too seriously and the world might not. That's a very different situation. I have a point, and that's where I want Kumar's answer, because he said media did stoke the wave. There is a very interesting data.
I don't agree the media stoked the wave.
I did not say that.
No, you did.
I did not say media stoked the wave.
You said media's conduct was very,
media's
very...
Media's conduct helped the wave.
Yes, exactly. That is what stoking means.
I never said, no.
All right, let's not get into a debate on that. But the point is, if media helped the wave, why is it that the states where the penetration of media is the poorest, Jharkhand, Bihar, UP, and many other parts like this, are the states where, also the states where the BJP did phenomenally well, probably
that's the point I made.
Better than states where the media penetration is very high. You know, Gujarat and Maharashtra have deep penetration, so you can say that media swung it. But what about Jharkhand, Bihar, and UP? You know, how do you explain the 73 or the whatever number of seats that the BJP got in states where there is no cable TV? And that's one thing that I do understand, where there is cable TV and where there is, you know, no cable TV.
That's the point.
Are we discussing seats or votes or
no.
vote shares?
Whatever
Modi
we are discussing.
Has got, Modi BJP has got only 31% of the vote share. 31% of the vote share was in 2009 of the Congress when they got only 206 seats. But I don't want to go into that.
That's
Rajdeep said media follows the headlines. Who makes the headline? People?
No.
Media makes the headline.
You're not answering my question.
It is the electronic media which sets the tone for the next day's printing press.
I agree, but...
And unfortunately...
The newspaper...
Unfortunately, the newsrooms
still,
today...
You're still not answering the question,
no,
Kumar.
I'm answering. News no. press rooms in the evening discuss what is on the TV. TV is guiding the press and TV is guiding the... rest of the campaigns. I'll just give you one example.
No, but Kumar, 1 minute. Only he's made one. A good point which you should answer.
No, I will answer. No, but one point. In... No, Piyush.
I'll come to you.
Piyush, 1 second.
As our senior most and eldest person, I think you should answer that question, which I've also tried, because you may have an answer to it that I don't. I think he made a valid point. Why is it in Jharkhand? In perhaps... A state where
or
cable
Bihar or Eastern UP.
Or Eastern UP where cable penetration is perhaps the least.
Yes.
Right? Where English language TV doesn't determine voter preferences. Also, let's be clear. You know, and that's where our hubris comes, that we believe we set the agenda. Why is it that in Eastern UP, in Jharkhand, in the poorest parts of the country, the BJP did very well. What explains the fact that the BJP did so well in the poorest parts of the country, where there is no television penetration? Obviously, there was anger against the Congress.
Yes.
Obviously, Modi was the right man at the right place, and he was able to use it. And why not just reduce, leave it at that? Why are we trying to use ourselves as the punching bags?
No, no, I'm not trying to use ourselves as punching bag, but let us remember, in 2011, April to August, there was no Modi. Because as he said, Modi's story begins in 2012, December. In 2011, April to August, there was no Modi. There was only one wave. That was Anna wave. And all 24/7 channels were talking, discussing only Anna movement, Anna movement, Anna movement throughout. And what happened after August? He came to Mumbai. He had a fast in December. And it fizzled out in exactly 24 hours. The entire Anna wave was also, much of it was media creation. And that's why I'm saying that media creation does not necessarily mean that you start, something happens, and then you promote it. Within 4 months of 16th August, when Anna was arrested and immediately released, within 4 months, every single electronic channel, every single media organization made him Man of the Year, Indian of the Year, Great Man of the Year, New Gandhi, and so on. I mean, that new Gandhi disappeared in December, well, just 4 months after.
May I add to this one?
Yeah.
See, no, you're living in an era...
No, 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 Piyush, only one thing.
Menka, since you have more experience, I'm handing it over to you.
Anna did not hire any advertising or campaign agency like yours was hired. Anna had no agency.
No, but the media...
Anna had no agency, and yet Anna dominated for 8 months.
But the media didn't ask. The media didn't ask Chidambaram to arrest Anna. The media did not ask Chidambaram to arrest Anna and put him in jail, did they?
Speak.
The point I was making, what you're talking about, is there was such a vacuum. There was such a vacuum.
Let me say one thing.
He didn't get a second round, so
okay.
Please.
30 seconds.
I won't take more than 30.
See, these are my seniors on my left.
I surrender.
Rajdeep has been my boss for a decade, and Kumar Ketkar is a very senior man. I won't quarrel with them. I'll just say one thing. We are getting too emotionally involved with our politicians. We should not get so emotionally involved. One small thing, I'll take 30 seconds. I look upon television as the impact of television. In December 2011, a 17-year-old girl was put in jail. You asked me about Mayawati. I say 17-year-old girl was put in jail because she had been raped by a BSP MLA and had been put into prison when she went to complain against the BSP MLA. For 2 weeks, when the media camped in Bandha, in Lakhimpur Kheri, in Uttar Pradesh, it became a big story. You think that does not have a trickle-down effect beyond television? I think it is a media awakening, whether we like it or not. It's not restricted to television, but I really would have a statutory warning that we shouldn't get so emotionally involved with our politicians. It's bad for our health.
On that note, I completely endorse what Arnab is saying. I think, and one point, last point, that Rajdeep started by saying, and I do think there is too much reverence even now in Indian media. And on the other hand, there is too much emotional involvement. Either we just completely are cynical, or when we go there, we get sucked in. There has to be a balance in between. But overall, I think we shouldn't be cynical about media. We have lots to catch up and improve. But without us, this country would be much worse. Thank you very much, everybody.
The winner of this debate is me. I have 4 mics. I had a side bet going with Gurbir. Uday, I had a side bet going on that you won't be able to ask more than one question, because thereafter they will talk till the end of our time. And you did 3, I think. So congratulations. Thanks. To Uday for being a great host, to Piyush for asking lovely questions as well and adding to the debate, and of course, to our 3 stars, Arnab, Rajdeep, and Kumar Ketkar. Thank you.